Professor Dave here. Let's explore the galaxy.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
On July 20th, 1969, American astronauts Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin landed a lunar module on the surface of the moon and stepped out to walk upon its surface. It was one of the greatest moments in human history, the first time that humans set foot upon an extraterrestrial body, a world other than our own Earth, our home. In that instant, humans became a space-faring civilization, as was captured in Armstrong's immortal words.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Much to the disappointment of science fiction fans everywhere, in the nearly 50 years since the moon landing, mankind has not set foot on any other worlds. Probes of our own engineering have touched down on or impacted the surfaces of Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Titan, two asteroids, and a comet, but not yet has a human being set foot on any of these worlds. Plans to send humans to Mars have been underway for many years, and it is nearly certain that this will be the next place we will visit in person. Venus is slightly closer, but utterly inhospitable, so Mars is the most logical choice. What will we do once we get there? Is Mars really a good place for humans to live? Well, the short answer is no, not at first. It's very cold, and there's no oxygen. Life would be limited to pressurized and temperature-controlled habitats, or at best, a futuristic dome. But believe it or not, we can fix that. Just the same way that excess carbon dioxide is causing global warming here on Earth, with negative ramifications due to a greenhouse effect, we can deliberately enact this process on Mars in order to make the climate more suitable for life. There is a lot of carbon dioxide and water locked away in the polar ice caps, and it wouldn't be that difficult to blast it up into the atmosphere with some huge bombs. Once it was distributed evenly around the planet, it would raise the temperature, which would begin to unlock more carbon dioxide locked in all the soil, and there would be a runaway effect, heating the planet relatively quickly, by cosmic timescales at least. Water vapor would condense and rain down to form oceans. Once it was warm enough, we could grow plants directly on the surface. And if the atmosphere became oxygenated enough, it should be possible for humans to walk around the surface of Mars with no spacesuit or protective layers of any kind, just as though we were walking around on Earth. This process of deliberately modifying the atmosphere, temperature, and even topology of another world to make it suitable for Earth life is called terraforming. And if we could achieve this on Mars, we would have a second world to live in. Mars is much smaller than Earth, so gravity is much weaker, which would make for some incredible Martian Olympic Games, where all the world records from Earth for long jump and high jump would be shattered easily by average people. So how long would terraforming take? Quite a long time, unfortunately. The most liberal of estimates predict several hundred years to get things suitable for a picnic, and more conservative ones say several thousand. There are also many things that could go wrong in the process, so it's not a sure thing. If we do something wrong and Mars becomes permanently uninhabitable, it will be all our fault, and killing a whole planet is a lot for anyone's conscience to bear. But perhaps one day we will get it right, and Mars will become the ultimate vacation spot. Where else might we go? Earlier in the series, we talked about some of the moons of Jupiter and Saturn, and a lot of these would be reasonable places to set up camp. Europa, Callisto, and Ganymede, orbiting Jupiter, as well as Enceladus and Titan, orbiting Saturn. As some of these are worlds that might already harbor life, a bonus could be some new friends to play with. We wouldn't be able to terraform due to the ethics involved with altering such biology-supportive worlds, so artificial habitats would be crucial. And the low gravity on these moons would be a problem for stays of long duration. But it seems inevitable that we will build a base on one or more of these worlds, even if just for research purposes. So how can we support such habitats? It's too expensive to bring lots of things with us from Earth. So how will we generate the energy and resources to sustain human life in these places? One pivotal technique would be asteroid mining. Asteroids contain a wide variety of substances that could be of use to us, like water and even some rare metals, like platinum. With so many asteroids ready to be mined just beyond Mars, and the ease of lifting off from them because of the negligible gravity, this is one method that would make living on Mars or one of Jupiter's moons quite a bit more feasible. So let's say we jump ahead a few centuries, and we've colonized a number of worlds in our solar system. What's next? Would it be feasible to colonize other systems? There's certainly nothing stopping us, but one huge hurdle is the immense distance required to go anywhere else. The closest star to us besides the Sun, Proxima Centauri, is a little over 4 light-years away. Even with the fastest speeds we have ever achieved with a spacecraft, it would take tens of thousands of years to get even just to this nearest system. So it is very clear that any colonization attempts of this nature would require a major paradigm shift in propulsion. We talked about some of these possibilities in the modern physics course when we discussed the future of space travel. So if you're interested in these hypothetical propulsion systems, check that one out now. Otherwise, it's not outrageous to think that such technology will come, and we will indeed begin to spread throughout the galaxy, with large populations on massive ships that go from one star to another within a human lifetime. A civilization of this level will need a lot of energy to sustain these new colonies, so fossil fuels absolutely won't cut it. Instead, we may need to harness the energy of the sun. We've already begun doing this with solar panels, but consider what a tiny fraction of the energy radiated by the sun is being captured by a little panel. This radiation goes outwards in all directions. Just imagine if we could harness all of that energy. A hypothetical structure that does just that is called a Dyson sphere. It seems far-fetched, but it might be possible to build some kind of structure comprised of many small objects that encompass the sun at some distance. This could be a spherical swarm of objects, or even simply a ring, and it would be able to harvest a tremendous amount of energy from that star. To harvest all of the energy, it would have to actually be a spherical shell, and this would yield an amount of energy trillions of times greater than the human race currently uses. There are a number of complications regarding gravity that arise with such a structure, and these would have to be solved. But a bonus would be the ability to live on the Dyson sphere itself, which would be unimaginably huge, with a surface area millions of times greater than the Earth. Whatever variety ends up being the most feasible, it seems that it will be difficult to reach a certain level of advancement relying on the resources found within a planet, and harnessing the power of a star will be crucial if we are to become an interstellar species. In fact, it has been proposed that we should be looking for precisely this kind of structure in space, as that would be pretty undeniable evidence of intelligent life. How would we distinguish between such a civilization and our own? There is a scale that measures how technologically advanced a civilization is. It's called the Kardashev Scale. This scale categorizes civilizations as being type 0, type 1, type 2, or type 3. Humanity comprises a type 0 civilization. We are still using crude forms of energy and have not yet figured out how to use all of the sun's energy that hits Earth's surface. A type 1 civilization has figured that out, and we may get to type 1 categorization within the century. We will have to be completely independent of oil and other fossil fuels, which is seeming more and more realistic by the decade. So the moment that humans will become a planetary civilization, or a type 1 civilization, seems to be just beyond the horizon. But if we became a civilization capable of creating a Dyson sphere or some similar structure, then we would be a Type II civilization, or stellar civilization. This is one that can harness all of the energy produced by a star. Beyond this, to become a Type III civilization, or a galactic civilization, we would have to be harnessing the energy of the entire galaxy. Perhaps this would have something to do with the supermassive black hole at galactic center, and a strange technique called black hole farming that has been hypothesized, which is actually quite mathematically sound. What type of civilization will mankind become? Will we colonize other worlds? Can we harness the energy of the sun? It's difficult to predict, as self-destruction is always a very real possibility. But that's why it's so important for us to be educated, so that we can remain on the same side and work together to create a bright future. In terms of being on the same page, there are a number of astronomy-related phenomena that the common public seems to be divided on, to one degree or another. So let's move forward and see what some of these topics could be. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.